Hey, what's up, guys? My name is Josh, and this is the HE1. Now, before we get into this, I have a couple thanks to give. One is to Sennheiser for setting this up with an audio store that is kind of local in the Seattle area called Definitive Audio. Now, this is a very, very nice store. It's actually one of the best that I've been able to find in Washington. They're located in Bellevue. The staff is amazing, and they've been providing hi-fi equipment since about 1975. So if you're in the Seattle area, I would definitely recommend checking them out. I also want to thank Daniela, Tom, and Zach specifically for helping me get this review all set up. And they've all been incredibly generous in offering me this time and this space to film in. And thank you guys. Now, as far as why this particular review is able to happen is because there is a notable shortage of reviews on YouTube of this headphone. All of them are really brief, or they're just impressions at a show or something like that. And so I wanted to do a thorough review. Now, personally, I like seeing this stuff a lot. I wish more companies in more fields would do this. This is one of the downsides to like Formula One. I miss the days when race cars were like really not held down by restrictions, and it was like, do whatever you want, just make the fastest or the best possible thing. And that's kind of what they did here. And I'm a huge fan of this type of product. I think it's a really, really cool thing. So one of the things here is that this is a headphone system. It comes with the DAC, it comes with the amplifier. So the case that holds the headphones that kind of pops up in this incredible otherworldly rising effect where the tubes are heating up and allowing you to kind of visually admire what's going on with the introduction of these headphones every time you turn it on. This case is made of Carrara marble, brass knobs, and anodized metals. Now, you can find a lot of this information online if you just go to their webpage for it, but a couple things that they won't tell you is that you can actually get this Carrara marble in different colors or a color choice of your own. You can also anodize the brass to be any color you want. So it doesn't have to be silver. If you wanted to do bright pink or dark blue, you could. And so in a lot of ways, this actually kind of reminds me a lot of the high-end car market from how you purchase this headphone, which we'll talk about in a future video, and kind of how the customization options happen. This is certainly one of those things where you can work with the dealer and work with Sennheiser on getting a unit that is really specific to you. Okay, now a couple other little small facts and tidbits about the HE1 here. Inside this headphone, you have 2.4 micrometer thick platinum vaporized diaphragms. You also have gold vaporized ceramic transducers, and the protective casing around the tubes is actually not glass, it's actually quartz. And this is, of course, to reduce incoming vibrations. Now, one interesting thing here, while I was listening to it, a lot of tube amps that I've heard are very susceptible to microphonics, and I was actually tapping on the quartz on the side just to see if anything got through. Just kind of light tap, and I couldn't hear anything. And I definitely didn't get any weird tube buzzing or anything like that. And for the price, you would not expect that. Now, the DAC and amplification system in here is a little bit strange and definitely unorthodox. So this actually has a total of 8 DACs inside of it, and there's 4 per each channel, 2 channels, obviously. Now, as far as why they have 4 DACs per channel on this, I'm not quite sure. I would suspect that it has something to do with cross-referencing the signal. So you're deleting or not playing anything that's unique to one signal. So you have like a kind of a point of reference times 4 of what the signal is supposed to look like, and they only put through the most refined version of that signal. That would just be a random guess. There's probably a reason for it though. Now, the ear cups for this are machined out of a single block of aluminum. And the funny thing about this headphone, the reasons why it's so unorthodox, is because the amplifier is actually inside the ear cups, and they just send the power and the DAC signal through the cable, and the amp is inside the ear cups. Now, this is a Class A MOSFET amplifier, and the reason why it's built into the headphones, according to Sennheiser, is to overcome capacitive reactance of the cable. I'm not sure what all that means, but That's why they do it. Okay, and then last fun fact, this headphone actually made an appearance in the movie Parasite, which is a very good movie. I actually spotted it by myself when I was watching the movie, had no idea it was in there. So go watch the movie, see if you can spot it. So let's get to the actual review portion of this. A lot to talk about here. We'll talk about the build first. So the build is very nice. There's a pretty liberal use of metal. They are weighty, but they're not overly heavy, and they're actually quite large. You know, in comparison to a lot of other headphones, these are gonna be bigger, wider in general compared to a lot of headphones on the market today. A couple standout features of this, the comfort is exquisite. The headband is super plush and extremely nice. The pads are very soft, and they say they use exquisite or nice materials on the website, and they're not lying. This thing is very, very well made, and the comfort is one of the top priorities for Sennheiser for the listener, and they definitely achieved that goal. There is a wide flexibility of head size that you can have with this, so this will fit very small heads and very big heads. So you got basically everybody covered. Now on the inside of those ear holes, they are very tall and fairly deep, but they're not super wide back and forth, so you may get a little bit of pressure on the back. The one and only complaint I have about the build for this headphone is the pads do get a little bit hot. I'm not sure if that has anything to do with the amplification built into this or if that is just because of the pad material. I'm also in a lit room with studio lights and everything like that, so it could be a small part of it. The DAC interface build is very nice. You know, you got the marble, the use of the brass knobs, everything seems to be top notch, top quality. It's got the automatic rising stuff, so in terms of visuals, in terms of the material feel and the material choices, all top notch, as again, you would expect. Okay, so the sound signature. This is a beautiful sounding headphone. And I say the word beautiful over any other word, I think. I'm not gonna say technical headphone. I'm not gonna say a clinical headphone. I'm not gonna say X, Y, or Z. It is a beautiful sounding headphone. It just sounds pretty. And it's really all throughout the range that this sounds pretty exquisite with, but we'll start with the treble response. The treble response, in my opinion, stands alone. The attack speed is immeasurable by my brain. It's just like sound is off and then it's on and it's just go. Now the tonality here is so good because of its defined boundaries. So it's not an overly saturated sound nor an undersaturated sound. It sounds very realistic in terms of, again, that detail retrieval, the tonality, the forwardness of the treble response. It seems quite more based in terms of trying to sound like real life than something that is trying to be a hyper technical or hyper detailed sounding headphone. It doesn't sound like that at all, actually. It's quite based in sounding real. Now, detail specifically is obviously present. There's obviously a lot of detail with this, but it's not at all forced. When I was coming into this, I was kind of predicting that this was gonna be just some detailed monstrosity where it was just gonna be just crazy, forced analytics into your brain. And it's not that. It's a very pleasing sound signature. It is detailed. To say it was not detailed would be a lie, but it's not some overly forced sound. The HE1's treble forwardness is very strange. In some ways, it's like perfectly featureless in like the best way. And it kind of just shrugs and does whatever the music is asking it to do. If you want an overly clinical, more sterile sound that you're putting through it, like a really crispy song, it's gonna do that. Or if you want something warm and lush, it's gonna do that. And the timbre characteristics ebb and flow, the detail forwardness ebbs and flows, the frequency forwardness is, you know, really just whatever the particular song is asking for. It's almost in some ways like the detail features are sort of hard to kind of get a finite, you know, kind of feeling for. And that's a very big compliment. I don't want that to sound like a detriment. That's really, really exceptional performance for that on the HE1. Now, mid-range response is where the tonality takes another step up, and it really, really grips you. This is still in that vein of trying to achieve a more lifelike sound, natural saturation to sound, not overly emphasized or underemphasized in any particular way. It's just very clear, concise, realistic. That being said, I find that the mid-range here is a thoroughly honest reproduction. So if you are putting something that was recorded too hot or somebody is singing in a way that is not quite hitting the right notes, you're gonna know. And this is going to pour all that sound through this headphone into your brain, and it's gonna be pretty unrelenting in that task. The flip side of this is that when the singer is doing their job correctly and when they're hitting the right notes, this is, simply put, the best vocal experience I have ever had on a headphone. It is exquisite. It's exceptional. Very good. Good doesn't even describe it. It is maddeningly awesome. One of the songs that I really liked, and we'll talk about songs and music in a second, is Mad World from Pentatonix, their cover of that song. Whew. It's nice. So bass response is something that I was concerned about because it's an electrostatic headphone. They're notoriously kind of picky and not the easiest to deal with. But the bass response here is simply shocking. It is as quick and as finitely placed and as fast and as clean as anything on the market, but it also hits quite hard and it's quite a bit deeper than, well, every other electrostatic that I've heard, but it has that cleanliness, that clarity to back the quantity of it up. Now, what this headphone won't do is introduce sloppiness to the bass response to keep up with quantity demand. So if you're pushing through like a really, really bassy track, what this headphone is gonna do is prioritize the cleanliness of that sound over the quantity. So you're never gonna get this oversaturated, boxy sound out of the bass, even if that's what the music is trying to force out of the headphones. So the bass response is one of the only areas where I felt like the headphone itself was limiting what the music is asking it to do. Now, in this particular way, I think it's limiting it in a good way because the quantity is still quite pleasing and more than enough, and you know, it'll all the way down to 20 hertz. I think the frequency response actually goes down to 8 hertz, and I would actually believe this with this electrostat, but it's not gonna play something super sloppy. It's gonna be as clean as really anything would be able to display bass response. Now, in terms of quantity, it's not like a super bass heavy headphone at all. It's kind of got a very natural Sennheiser-y type of bass with a little bit of guts and a little bit of flavoring behind it. It's quite enjoyable, and it definitely feels substantial when it needs to feel substantial. Like if you're listening to a really bassy track, you'll know it. But there are bassier headphones out there, but I think cleanliness and clarity of the bass response is as good on this headphone as any other. Okay, so for imaging and soundstage, this is where things get sort of complicated, and I wanna be very descriptive about how I explain this. So the imaging is absolutely refined. Like, you're not gonna find sharper, more pinpoint accurate imaging, I don't think anywhere. I think this is about as good as it gets, and there's no headroom after this, at least in terms of what I've heard. What's notably good about the imaging is the precision of placement for the entire frequency response. So bass response, normally, on most headphones, is kind of sloppy in comparison to this. This doesn't have this loose bleeding of the edges of like a bass guitar or a drum, where you can tell that, you know, the mid-range and the treble are in a specific place, but then the bass is kind of ambient and sort of kind of loosely placed. This isn't like that at all. The placement of the bass is as refined as the mid-range and the treble response. So when you hear a guitar over here, you are hearing all of the guitar, the entire frequency over here. And when the track needs kind of a bassy, kind of all-encompassing surrounding response, this can also play that. So the dexterity of the bass response, the dexterity of all of the frequency response is exquisite. And that's what really sets this headphone apart from basically everything else in terms of imaging. Now the sound staging, this is where this headphone starts to be obvious about what it's intended to do. This is a very headphone-based sound. This is all pretty much happening on the sides of your head and internally. The forward representation is kind of good, but it's actually not the best of all the headphones I've heard. It's a very kind of in your head, very personal, very intimate listening experience. That's exactly what you get with this. Now, what you can kind of imagine is the vocal positioning of an HD660S, but with much wider and more open soundstage, but even not as wide as another Sennheiser headphone, the HD800S. That's further out to the sides. What this has over those and over a lot of headphones is scale and height and largeness to the sound, even though it's not super wide. So you get the personalization aspect, but then also the scale, but everything definitely seems very close-knit, very intimate, very personal. A track that's exceptional at showing the scale of this was 747 from the new Tenet soundtrack. That song on this headphone is bonkers. It is really good. Okay, so music. This is actually a big internal discussion for me of like, all right, I'm gonna go listen to arguably the best headphone on the planet. What do I listen to that is worthy of the headphone? So what I decided on was a series of songs that I felt like were a good mix of kind of more technical tests like bass, you know, depth and soundstage width and detail retrieval and all that fun stuff, impulse response, all that fancy stuff. And then also things that I just personally really liked, because the odds of me getting another crack at this thing alone for this amount of time is not too high. So I wanted to take full advantage if I could. I will talk about the songs that I used in a separate video. I'll make a follow-up video to this one. I'll get more in depth than that. But the reason why I bring this up is because I also wanted to test all the different genres, everything from super refined songs like Diana Krall to more pop music. Like I even threw some Weeknd on this just to see how it handled more mainstream music. This headphone is top notch in every genre. So you can throw anything at this and this is gonna be able to display it in a really, really enjoyable way. It's gonna be awesome for everything. Again, like you would expect, but again, not every headphone is good at everything. This headphone is great at everything. Okay, so my conclusion here. To call this headphone exquisite or amazing or any regular term for awesome would be an understatement, I think. This is an exceptional headphone. It is an exceedingly good headphone and, well, headphone system, really. And that's it. I've capped out my vocabulary for what I can call this headphone that would explain what it's capable of and how good it sounds. I think the most apt word, again, like I started this review with, is that this is a headphone that sounds beautiful. So I also want to try and refine, a sentence or two that gives you kind of the closest description of the sound quality, even though this is something that you'd want to listen to for yourself. This is like the best possible version of the HD 600 series sound signature. So everything that the 600 is good at, the 600 series, the 660S, all that, this is like that, but just way overdone. Like just this is the most refined version of that type of sound signature. So normally I would go kind of standout features and features that could be better or are bad. The standout feature is that there isn't any bad here. The tonality was one of the standout features though. The clarity of the vocal response is one of the standout features. And then of course the entire presentation, the looks, the kind of halo around this headphone. If you're in the market for something like this, I think this is going to be perfectly satisfactory for what you're looking for. I want to thank Sennheiser again for helping set this up. Thank you, Daniela and Tom. I appreciate it. And I also want to send a big thank you to Zach with Definitive Audio in Bellevue, Washington. So check it out, guys. It's right outside of Seattle area. Until the next video, my name is Josh, signing off.